because you're going to have to really get those high notes in. So we're going to remember their request from the morning. Mike, you go ahead. Then Jim.
Father, we love you so. And God, we don't always even have the words how to thank you. You're so great, God, that it's inconceivable for us to really, really, really understand how great you are. God, you gave your son that our sins could be forgiven. God, you've got the world under control. God, man's made a mess sometimes. But God, we've come at this particular time, Lord, to lift up those that have special needs or requests for the morning. Oh, for Sister Kudel, for Aaron. God, you know the names, you know the situations, you know the need, even before we came to this place. So God, we put our hearts and minds together, Lord, asking for the sweet presence of your Holy Spirit. God, what comfort is needed, we ask for comfort. What healing is needed, we ask for prayer, for faith, for belief. God, we know that you love us, we know you hear our prayer, and God, we thank you for that. Lord, tonight, we feel your presence already. We pray your Holy Spirit upon Jim. Lord, he brings a message, God, to touch him in an extraordinary way. So God, we just ask that your name be lifted up, that it not be about a single one of us here, but we've come to praise you and love you and lift your name. In Jesus' name, amen.
Going up, we're going and cast away the way. So shall it be at the end of the world. The angels shall come forth and shall sever the wicked from among the just, and shall cast them into a furnace of fire. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Jesus said unto them, to the disciples, have you understood all these things? They said unto him, yea, Lord. Then said he unto them, therefore of a scribe, which is instructed into the kingdom of heaven, is like to a man that is a householder, which bringeth forth out of his treasure things new and things old. Father, I thank you for the privilege to stand up here this evening behind this sacred pulpit. I thank you, dear God, that I have the privilege tonight to lift up our blessed Lord and Savior, your Son, Jesus Christ. The Bible says that Jesus said, if I be lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men unto him. So Father, that's the reason we're here. We want to draw people into a closer and a greater relationship with the shepherd of the sheep, which is Jesus Christ. Bless your word and bless our congregation. We ask it all in the precious name of Jesus, who will say, amen. Most of us understand what a parable is. It is a story given in the natural, but it has a spiritual meaning and thought. A metaphor, or it's a comparison. In this chapter, in chapter 13, Jesus has just preached about seven different parables. The first parable was the parable of the sower. The second parable was the parable of the tares. The third was the mustard seed. The fourth was the lamb. Fifth was the hidden treasure. The sixth was the pearl of great price. And the seventh was the sheep net, was the fish net. In this chapter, Jesus is sitting in a boat, one of the fishing boats, and he's out there on the boat, and the crowd is sitting on the beach. I can hear the small rivers, small waves, smiting up against this boat that Jesus is sitting in. I can hear it because me and my dad, we had a little John boat when we did a lot of trout fishing. We did a lot of trout fishing up at the boat on the scamp. And when we would anchor our little boat, you'd hear those little waves just beating up against the boat. And I can hear these little waves beating up on the boat where Jesus is teaching from. At least four of the 12 disciples were fishermen. Peter and Andrew were brothers. James and John were brothers. And I don't know if any other of the 12 were fishermen or not. But everyone who weren't fishermen, they depended on the catch from those who weren't fishermen. If they wanted any meat on the table, they hoped that the fishermen would bring in a net full of fish. You know, You didn't tell me your little mule or your little donkey, your hemi, your camel, and ride to the fish store. If the fisherman didn't bring in pets, then he just might have some vegetables for your supper. But you know, I always like a little meat on my table. Looking a little deeper in our scripture, I see that the net represents the gospel. And the sea represents the world for mankind. And the fish, they are the people. You know, fish will be a lot easier to deal with than people. If the preacher caught a bad fish, all he would have to do is hit him a ball-peen hammer and caught the bad fish upside the head and just throw him aside. But you know, I don't think it's legal in our church. Is it right, though?
No, it isn't.
So, we can't do that. But I think God would, you know, if we did do something like that, boy, God would have us in his office in a heartbeat, and woe be the preacher who was in there in the office of God. So, the moral of this story is what? Fact is that there is a heaven to the game, and that there is a hell to shun. Did you know that heaven and hell are both deeply rooted in the Holy Scriptures? Hell is rooted in the Scriptures just as deeply as what heaven is. You know, we said, can't be this year. And on Tuesday night, Lenny Weishart preached a message about hell, about the lake of fire. I've never heard a campaign preacher ever preach on hell as long as I've been on the campaign. It seemed like it was a special type of service, because I felt that God was all over everybody. You know, I've been back in the good old days, back in the old time camp meetings. I could just hear the people saying to each other and to themselves, "How we see doggone preachers who quit preaching on hell. That's all they preach on every night. They always preach on hell. Why don't they ever preach on him?" That's why we said that. Because by George, these old country camp meeting preachers, they was filled with fire with the Holy Ghost, brother. Praise God. Me and Tammy was coming to the church this past Wednesday evening. You come up and go, I saw this church sign on a church. And it says that life has many choices, but eternity only has two. But eternity only has two. Now, most people in here
Uncle Bud Robinson used to say, God voted for me, the devil voted against me, and I cast the deciding votes. Folks, that's true. Life has a lot of different choices, but it'll be eternity. Only has two. Did you know that you and God are a majority? You and God, you're a majority. Heaven is a prepared place for a prepared people. Then hell must be a place for an unprepared people. You know, Paul makes the gospel very simple. What is the gospel? Well, Paul tells us in Acts chapter 20, in verse 21. Paul says, this is the gospel, testifying to the Jew and also to the Greek, repentance towards God and faith in Jesus Christ. Folks, that's gospel in a nutshell. Repentance towards God and faith in Jesus Christ. 1 John 5:12 tells us, he that hath the Son hath life, but he that hath not the Son has not life. Going back to our scripture in Matthew 13, who are the good fish? Well, who are the good catch? Those who are the Son of God. Those who have the Son of God living and abiding in their souls. Who is the bad fish? Who's the bad catch? It's those who do not have the Son of God in their life. The good catch are the saved people. The bad catch are those who are lost. The good belong to God, but the bad belongs to Satan. As I prayed and read the study for this message, I remember a verse in Isaiah, and I won't turn there, because I remember Isaiah said that hell has enlarged itself. And I began to get kind of curious to know what that meant. Hell is enlarging itself. In Isaiah chapter 5, and I won't read these two verses to you. Isaiah chapter 5, verses 13, 14, and 15. Isaiah 5, 14, and 15 says, therefore hell has enlarged herself and opened her mouth without measure, and their glory and their multitude and their pomp, and he that rejoices shall descend into it, and the mean man shall be brought down low, and the mighty man shall be humbled, and the eyes of the lofty shall be humbled. I thought, how is hell enlarging itself? Well, there's two different ways You know, that's true. That we're relying on ourselves. That we're relying on ourselves. That we're trusting within ourselves. That is true. Charles Spurgeon, who was called the Christian preachers, was preaching a sermon. And he just finished up. And you know how people take screens and, you know, how people, you know, talk against and all. Well, this fellow went up to Charles Spurgeon and he said, Mr. Spurgeon, I enjoyed your message. But he said, you know what I'm doing? I'm looking for the perfect church. I'm looking for the perfect church. Charles Spurgeon, I used to say now, he said, my friend, when you look at everybody, when you go into that church, don't join it, because they don't want to be a perfect church. You know, that's true, isn't it? How does how does hell enlarge itself? Jesus gives us a good idea here in Matthew 23 and verse 13. He says, but woe unto the scribes, the Pharisees, hypocrites, for you shut up the kingdom of heaven against men. For neither ye go in yourselves, neither suffer them that are going therein too. You can make heaven almost an impossibility. That's what the Pharisees and Sadducees did. I mean, they Jesus said, you're not going in yourselves, and you're not going in anybody else's room. So one way that heaven enlarges itself is for your faith. Too hard. Amen. But you know, Isaiah 35:8 says, and a highway shall be there, and a way, and it shall be called the way of holiness. The unclean shall not pass over, but it shall be for those wayfaring men, those fools shall not enter therein. I'm glad that God simplifies how we get to heaven in His Son Jesus. The other reason that hell and offers itself is many creatures makes heaven too easy to get into. You know, everybody is going to heaven. I ain't read that in my Bible yet. You know, 2 Timothy 3:4 says, for the time will come when they will no longer endure sound doctrine. But after their own lusts shall they heap to themselves teachers, having itching ears, and they shall turn away their ears from the truth, and shall be turned to fables. In other words, for this group of people, we get anything goes. That's not in my Bible either. And that's not in your Bible either. Anything goes. You know, Jesus says there, and I need to sit with my notes. But Jesus says there in St. Matthew chapter 7, he says, wide is the gate and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many be that go in there be that findeth. If my mind is thinking right, when I was in Bible school at Charleston, in our church history class, I didn't get a lot of anything in Bible school, but I love to study scripture and I love to study church history. And if my mind is thinking right, I think it was around the middle of the 1700s when modernism began to infiltrate the church. What is modernism? Anything goes. But that's not in the Bible, is it? We got to walk the straight path. We got to walk the narrow path. You know, I don't like modernism. I don't like that word. And I definitely don't like the word literalism. It just makes my skin crawl. You know, I've got my own little definition for liberalism. Three L's. Let loose the rules. Let loose the rules. Friend, I tell you, Lucifer is loose today. He is on a rampage. He's in the church. He's in the government. He's in the home. He's got his nose in everything. You know, the Bible tells us, the Bible says that hell was made for the devil and his angels. It wasn't made for man. Then said Jesus, then shall he say unto them, on the left, on the left, depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. Depart into everlasting fire, prepared for the devil. Now, hell was made for man. We all understand that. It was made for the devil and for his angels. You know, I think one of the worst things, of course, hell is terrible. It's hell. It's the lake of fire. But you know what I think reason hell is going to be so bad? Because God made the lake of fire for the devil. And imagine what all the devil is responsible for. Man, you know, God's not going to have no mercy on the devil nor his angels. It's going to be hell, hell, hell. Hot, hot, hot. But the sad thing about it, the laws are going to be there. The laws. Who's the laws? It's those who don't know Jesus Christ as their Lord and personal Savior. Jesus said, I come that ye might have life, and that ye might have it more abundantly. Love to the devil. Love to hell if he's called on this earth. No wonder Proverbs 4:23 with all diligence. Well, out of it are the issues of life. What is the issues of life? It's spiritual vitality, which means that you have tapped into the tree of life. Friend, I'm glad that I tapped into the tree of life over 47 years ago. I'm glad I tapped into the tree of life. Who's the tree of life? It's Jesus Christ. He is the tree of life.
Being a child of God, being a priest.
swim in that stream. It's more than reading your Bible when you feel like it. How many people are missing out on the love thing with God? Because they will get rooted and grounded in the Word of God. You know, Jesus said, the man's not living by bread alone, but by the Word. By a free word that proceeded out of the mouth of God. Being a Christian is more than just praying when we need to pray. We shouldn't have just a need to pray. We should be glad that we can get on our knees and that we can communicate with Almighty God. Day in and day out. I heard somebody say many years ago, he said, when you're on your knees, you're taller than the trees, and I believe that. Paul says, pray without ceasing. Don't just pray when you have a need or not when you want something, but pray about God. Yeah.
Joshua said, as for as when I
tell the surgeon. Because he has said so much for me. He has saved me. Sanctified me. Gave me a wonderful family. You know those things you just cannot give up. Those you cannot give up. I thank God for all the people here. I'm not worthy of what Jesus did on the cross. None of us is worthy of what Jesus did. But he came to be one in life. Eternal life. And I'm glad. That God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. I hope that everybody here has an understanding. To serve Jesus. What greater joy can we have than to be in God's family? I'm glad that we can have God's DNA in our life. Father, we thank you for this privilege. That I had to read and to speak about your goodness, about your mercy, about your grace. Father, I pray for each of the person who is in this sanctuary. God, you're such a wonderful God. You are a compassionate God. You are a God that when we call you, your thumb is never missing. You always are waiting for Jimmy or Joe or George or Sue or Susan or Pam or Isaiah. God, you're always listening.